Hey guys, this is David Kwan. So, I'm sure you probably already know this if you know me, but I am a huge Metal Gear fan. I pretty much liked every single Metal Gear game that was released, except I didn't like Metal Gear Acid 2 as much. I know that's a spin-off. And I haven't yet played Metal Gear Rising. I don't know how I would feel about that game. Judging by the fact that I haven't played it yet, probably, you know, shows you that I'm not extremely excited to play it, but it's on my list of games to play in the future. I've watched Rising playthrough, so I know what happens in it. I know the story, at least, and how it plays. I kind of know of it, but I haven't actually played it myself. But Rising is a whole other matter. This video is about Metal Gear Solid 4. Recently, I watched this video by the user JermtheWorm26, and he made the video Metal Gear Solid 4 was a big disappointment. And this response is a little late because he made the video like back in 2013, a couple of months ago, or maybe like a year ago almost. So this video response is very late, but here's my thoughts on it anyway. You know, I want to talk about Metal Gear Solid 4, and I feel like responding to this video is a good stepping point to discussing it. So Metal Gear Solid 4, the first time I played it, you know, I thought it was an amazing experience. I had such fun with it. JermtheWorm26, even the first time, didn't like it. He thinks it's a terrible game, I guess, by Metal Gear standards. The worst Metal Gear game. And I think at the end of the video, JermtheWorm26 says it's like it's not a 10 or 9 game, it's like a 7 or 6 game, if that. So that's kind of his overall judgment on Metal Gear Solid 4. My overall judgment on Metal Gear Solid 4, like, it's been kind of, I don't know, there's been recalibrations here and there from June 2008 to this moment in time. And that recalibration happened especially after I played Peace Walker. So there is that involved. And also, like JermtheWorm26, I played Metal Gear Solid 4 over and over again many times. JermtheWorm26 mentions that he, you know, beat the game on the hardest difficulty with no alerts. So I'm assuming that means he got the Big Boss emblem, which I too also have. I have a Platinum Trophy on Metal Gear Solid 4, which Platinum Trophy on Metal Gear Solid 4 requires at least 7 playthroughs of the game. So just know, like, JermtheWorm26 played Metal Gear Solid 4 a lot, and of course, so have I, but I'm a diehard Metal Gear fan, so that makes sense. It's just that I guess his opinion on the game is extremely different than mine, which is fine. You know, we all have differences in opinions. That's what makes discussions so interesting. What I find really interesting about JermtheWorm26 is that he just doesn't like Metal Gear Solid 4. He likes Metal Gear Solid, Metal Gear Solid 2, Metal Gear Solid 3. Actually, I'm not sure. He hasn't mentioned the other Metal Gear games, so I'm just going to stick to 1, 2, 3, and 4. Although, like, I would feel like playing Peace Walker is pretty important now, but we won't go there. So when he made this video, before making this video, he replayed Metal Gear Solid 4 in 2013, and then, you know, he to kind of validate his opinion, like, okay, so this is what I felt when I first played the game, and I still kind of feel this way about this game now. You know, it's a terrible game. You know, it's not a good game. Boring cutscenes. Long-ass boring cutscenes. The only good gameplay is in Act 1 and Act 2. So that's kind of the overall message of this video. The overall message, I mean, I feel like it's been said so many times by this point by people who don't like Metal Gear Solid 4 or the franchise as a whole. You know, like, oh, you know, you're paying for a movie. Kojima should make movies, not games. Those kind of comments. They existed even with the release of Metal Gear Solid 2, and with the release of Metal Gear Solid 3, but I think Metal Gear Solid 4 really like exacerbated those kind of comments. So it's really interesting to me that he likes Metal Gear Solid 2, and it's such a contrast to him, Metal Gear Solid 2 to Metal Gear Solid 4. I mean, some parts he says, yeah, like some parts of it which contrived and convoluted, which is the criticism of Metal Gear Solid 2. I'll kind of agree with that, but I'll go into more detail And it's like, but, you know, the cutscenes were interesting. They were fun because the story was interesting. The story was not boring like Metal Gear Solid 4, which is his main argument. The Metal Gear Solid 4 story was boring. So, watching the video, I knew I couldn't remember everything he said, so I kind of typed up my notes during watching it. So I'm going to go kind of by the bullet points that I have in response to this video. So this is like kind of like a point-by-point video response, which I don't normally do that often. So I would imagine we're 5 minutes in. I think this video is going to be a pretty long one. But then again, we're talking about Metal Gear Solid 4. Discussions about this game usually tend to be long, just like the cutscenes of the game, sure, or the franchise. So, first thing he mentions is that JermtheWorm26 didn't really like Snake being an old character. You know, when he first bought it, he didn't feel that, he didn't like it, he didn't see the point to it. But then he kind of dismisses it because he was like, yeah, but that's just how the game looks, you know, so I'm not gonna be I don't care too much deeply about that. Okay, so that kind of was off-putting to me, actually. So you not liking to play as an old character that you grew up as playing, like, you know, Solid Snake is a badass character in MGS1 and MGS2 especially. He's just such an amazing character. Metal Gear Solid 3, you played as Big Boss, but pretty much identical to Solid Snake in appearance. Nearly identical, but not quite. Which makes sense, which MGS4 actually explains. So, you know, you're used to playing this badass character for 3 games. For 5 games if you play Metal Gear and Metal Gear 2. But now, he's an old character, you know, that can be off-putting. This, I can understand. But the comment about this just being aesthetics, or this just how things look, totally wrong. That's totally wrong. Snake being old has such significance to this game. Not just in terms of story, but also in terms of gameplay as well. That's why the psych meter thing kind of exists. There's so many gameplay elements to this. You can't roll around too much and you get dizzy and you'll vomit. There's really like his smoking addiction, his kind of feebleness, and there's also the link that Kojima makes, you know, like, I'm feeling like kind of jaded as a game maker myself, so I'm putting that image to this character that I have. So there's that kind of fourth wall breaking element with the character Old Snake. And fourth wall breaking element is an element that is pretty much a staple of the Metal Gear franchise. So, yeah, you know, so that was what was off-putting to me. And then, of course, this whole point about Act 1 and Act 2 were the only parts where the gameplay was good. He literally says Act 3 is the start of this game being bad, which is an opinion that many people share who don't like Metal Gear Solid 4. I totally disagree. Sure, Act 3, the first time I played it, I hated it. I hated Act 3. Well, at least the chasing the part. You know, the first time I played it, the Jeep on rail sequence, I was like, whoa, like, this is the first time Metal Gear actually has a franchise is doing this. It was pretty intense, pretty amazing. That part is one of the most frustrating parts if you're going for Big Boss Emblem. But that's a different topic. You know, that part is just like, oh my gosh, why did they have this part? If you're trying to get a Big Boss Emblem, that part will just make you throw your controller, you know, the Jeep sequence. But, you know, if you're just playing it just to enjoy it, it's a pretty fun sequence. You know, I especially enjoyed the whole, like, slow motion, the Jeep flipping apart, and you're like shooting while upside down. Like, that was a cool sequence, you know? And that was still gameplay, you know? And it's, I think the idea is that this conception of Metal Gear as being like, this is the game it's supposed to be, you know, just sneaking around, doing things. I think that mindset is what makes it hard for this gap, because each act, Act 1 and Act 2 are pretty similar, but each act in this game are very significantly different in how you approach with gameplay. I was having this internet, you know, conversation with the YouTube user, and the person was like, "Yeah, but MGS4, you know," he was talking about like how MGS Metal Gear as a franchise after 3 started declining in quality, or after 2, I think, was something like that. Because he was like, you know, MGS4, for example, just didn't have enough gameplay. And that's an interesting statement. Like, what didn't have enough gameplay? MGS4 has about the same amount of gameplay as MGS2. Seriously. Like, the amount of, the length of it, the same. If you include all the gameplay elements of MGS4 and compare it to MGS2, about the same amount. What is different is that the type of gameplay in MGS4 is different. It's super varied. You know, there's the type of sneaking around. There's the fight, you know, trailing footprints, trailing a resistance member, riding on a jeep, you know, boss fights. There's many, many boss fights in MGS4, Rex versus Ray boss fight, and so there is the same amount of gameplay as MGS2. So the thing about less gameplay, I don't think is true. Maybe it's the less gameplay of what you wanted out of a Metal Gear game. That's probably true. And that's, I think that's what makes or breaks the game for many people who don't like Metal Gear Solid 4. Act 3, like I said, the first time I did it, I was really frustrated. But then, like, I think the second or third time I tried it on the hardest difficulty, it was really fun. Because there's a set way that the resistance member kind of does, and you get to see, like, all kinds of funny stuff that happens as you trail around. And you get to, if you use your Metal Gear Mark 3 is after Act 3. Metal Gear Mark 2, and you use that really clever way, that's a pretty fun sequence. That sequence is boring after, like, when you're trying to do Big Boss Emblem Run. After that point, that Act 3 is pretty bad. And I would agree, Act 3 has the worst boss fight. So Act 3, if you're doing a Big Boss Emblem, the worst part, like the Jeep sequence, the most frustrating part to get a Big Boss Emblem. And also, the boss fight is the most unimaginative and kind of a boring boss fight overall for Act 3. But then, you know, next bullet point. There's no build-up to boss fights in Metal Gear Solid 4 was one of his criticism of Metal Gear Solid 4. I'm trying to think, I get the sentiment, but at the same time, I'm not sure if that's exactly true. You know, Beauty and the Beast unit are mentioned in the beginning. There's a cutscene of them doing stuff in the beginning, and Drebin kind of, I think Drebin talking about each boss after you defeat them is kind of a build up to like what kind of people these are. But you're just talking about the Beauty and the Beast unit. It's not like the whole game, the only bosses you fight are the Beauty and the Beast unit. You fight many different kinds of bosses. You fight Vamp, you fight against Rex, Ray using Rex, you fight Ocelot himself. So many people have really negative opinions about this, but Psycho Mantis is in this game. So not really a boss fight, but the build-up to Screaming Mantis is part of Psycho Mantis. So there is build-up there, maybe not as much as you like for the Beauty and the Beast unit, but it is there. Maybe it's not the build-up that you like. That's probably it then. You know, and it's not like the build-up in boss fights in Metal Gear Solid 3 was any better. Seriously, there is no build-up to boss fights in Metal Gear Solid 3. If you like Metal Gear Solid 3 for its boss fights, or the way it does handles bosses, then I don't really see that as how you can complain about Metal Gear Solid 4 the way it does it, because it does it more. Like, Metal Gear Solid 3 is just like, oh, this is the Cobra unit, you know? I feel like in terms of the way the game introduces the bosses, Metal Gear Solid 3 was the worst. It was like the most simplistic, you know? And there are some pros and cons of that. The pro is there's a lot of mystery to the Cobra unit. And finding more about, you know, for example, the Sorrow, you know, meant that you had to dig into the Coda conversations to find out what he was about. So there's no build-up necessarily per se, but it kind of encourage players to seek out on their own what the bosses were like. And Metal Gear Solid 4, I think, does a poor job of enticing players to learn more about the bosses. Because they have pretty similar stories, pretty tragic stories. I think that was kind of the somber tone going for this. You know, you don't have that burning hate for the villains in Metal Gear Solid 4. In fact, it's hard to say, are there villains in Metal Gear Solid 4 other than Bam? There are no villains, necessarily, in Metal Gear Solid 4. I think that's one of the messages of Metal Gear Solid 4 and 2, really. You know, in the Metal Gear Solid universe, it's hard to say, oh my gosh, there's this one person that's a villain. The only exception to that is Metal Gear Solid 3. There were a lot of villains in 3. You know, Bulgan, clearly a bad guy. There is no in-between feelings about Bulgan. Or much of the Cobra unit, you know. But Cobra unit, I think, was loyalty to the boss. You know, it's not like they were evil themselves, but out of loyalty to the boss. And you find out the boss wasn't really a villain herself. You know? Although, if you play Peace Walker, Big Boss comes to see that the boss was wrong. And that's why he actually comes to accept the name Big Boss. But sorry, Peace Walker, sorry. Let me not mention Peace Walker again. But like I said, Peace Walker changes things. The way we view Metal Gear Solid 4 story, the way we view the whole saga, I think Peace Walker changes things. And I think Phantom Pain will also change things when that comes out. But yeah, this whole thing about, like, he's a villain, you know, like, like we need to feel that intense feeling about these bosses and these villains. I think those are misplaced feelings in this franchise as a whole, because the great thing about Metal Gear Solid franchise is that villains are more multifaceted than that. They have, you know, they have more dynamic to them than that. In Metal Gear Solid 4, of course, the explanation is that three of the beasts are being controlled by Screaming Mantis. And Screaming Mantis herself is being controlled by the spirit of Psycho Mantis. That's why their personality is that way. It's that, you know, the whole message of Metal Gear Solid 4 is that war has changed, and war changes people. And this is definitely an example of that. If you noticed, each Metal Gear game has a theme behind it. And the theme of Metal Gear Solid 4, I believe, is... what was it? Oh, crap. Sorry. Metal Gear Solid 1 was jeans, 2 was memes, 3 was scene, 4, God, what was 4? I kind of forgot the theme of 4, but there was a theme behind that, and that's what makes sense if you have that theme behind it. Yeah, so that's kind of my point about the bosses. And another point that he made, why make all these guns so amazing if you can only use them in Act 1 and Act 2? Well, that's just not true. You can use guns in all 5 acts. Understand, like, you know, just because you have no human enemies in Act 4 doesn't mean you didn't use them. You use them, you know, you use all your weapons pretty much throughout the entire game. The only parts you really didn't use your weapon was the final fight against Ocelot. That's really it. All right, another point. Draven is an unneeded character. And he says he's so unneeded because, you know, he's just there to explain the Beauty and the Beast. That's pointless because anyone could have done that. Anyone could have explained the Beauty and the Beast. Again, not true. That's not true because to know about the Beauty and the Beast, you have to be a member of the Patriots or you have to be linked somehow because that knowledge is not just something that anyone knows. So already, there's a suspicion there. Like, how does Draven know all these things? You know, I think I already had that suspicion by Act 2 when I first played the game. I was like, Draven knows all these things. That doesn't make any sense how he knows all these things. How can you know all these things? Well, that's explained in the ending, how Draven knows all those things. So he's not necessarily pointless. Maybe you just felt like he's just, like, kind of a throwaway character. I understand he could feel like that, but he was a pretty cool character, I think. And the only really kind of pointless character, I think, in Metal Gear Solid 4. And I think, you know, you can kind of justify all of them together. So there's 2 pointless characters, actually. Most people would agree that Johnny Sasaki was a pointless character in Metal Gear Solid 4. He's just there for kind of whatever. And that's why people are really upset when he ends up marrying Meryl, you know? Like, oh my god, seriously? Meryl ends up marrying Johnny? Like, what? That you know, that's, I get the frustration and upset behind that. So I would agree, he's kind of like a pointless character. He was unneeded. But you know, it was interesting that he was there. I think that's my personal opinion. But the character that I just saw, I'm just like, whoa, he was not necessary in this game at all. Is JermtheWorm26. Seriously, JermtheWorm26. But I think I really like JermtheWorm26 as a character. I don't see him as pointless because, at least because of that, just because it is linked to the Patriots. Next point. The story is mind-bogglingly bad. It literally ruins a lot of the story of the older games for him. So, story is mind-bogglingly bad. I don't really, you know, he thinks it's kind of like, it's not interesting. That's one of his criticism. That is kind of simple. Well, no, not simple, but he says it's not interesting. And that's a very kind of a subjective critique. So I don't really know how to respond to that. Story is mind-bogglingly bad. I don't think it's mind-bogglingly bad. I'll just disagree on that. You know, I don't think it's mind-bogglingly bad. I think the storytelling could have been better, definitely. You know, and it's convoluted, just like how Metal Gear Solid 2 is convoluted. But the story hits, and you mentioned like, Metal Gear Solid 2 is interesting because it has a lot of interesting themes and whatever. I also think Metal Gear Solid 4 has a lot of interesting themes. For example, Drebin is an interesting thing, right? He's a child soldier who can make, who found the kind of what do you call it? Like, how do I say this? He found a way to bypass some of the Patriots' secret locks, you know? Although we find out later that's because the Patriots allowed him to do so. It's the only way, because this is controlled society. So I really like that portion of it. You know, the theme of everything is under control, even war. In fact, it's that this is the war economy. That's one of the themes of Metal Gear Solid 4, the concept of war economy, which is barely touched on by any games still today. You know, and this was an important theme at that time. You know, Iraq War was still going on, at that time, you know, big private military companies were actual realities in the news. So, I feel like if that's not interesting to you, I don't know. Like, that's just not interesting to you. That's your perspective. I think that's pretty interesting. Next point. Way too many cutscenes. Metal Gear Solid 2 cutscenes were not boring, but Metal Gear Solid 4 cutscenes were very boring. So I remember when in high school, right? I was this huge, big Metal Gear game nerd. I wanted everyone to experience it. So I had a friend who really just plays Call of Duty and Halo, right? And so I had a friend that was like, dude, you have to at least like watch me play this game or try to play it. He didn't want to play it. Doesn't like it. This gameplay was like too slow and whatever. It's like, all right, fine. You need to experience Metal Gear at least. So both of us, I replayed Metal Gear Solid 1 for him. He watched it. I replayed Metal Gear Solid 2 for him, and he watched it. Metal Gear Solid 2, he was bored out of his fucking mind a lot of the time. So whether you say, you know, Metal Gear Solid 2 cutscenes were not boring, subjective. Because Metal Gear Solid 2 had a lot of parts where just like, you know, codec conversations. You know, just you're just watching two 3D animations of faces just talking to each other. Codec conversations. A lot of people would find that boring, just like my friend did. I didn't find it boring because I thought the conversation was super intriguing and interesting. You know, I like little details like that. So when you say Metal Gear Solid 2 cutscenes were not boring, but Metal Gear Solid 4 cutscenes were boring, I don't really know. You know, maybe I think the thing is Metal Gear Solid 4 had a lot of briefing cutscenes, right? The briefing cutscenes in a lot of the Metal Gear games are kind of optional. So they're kind of in Metal Gear Solid 4. That's probably it. Way too many cutscenes thing, I think, objectively speaking, MGS4 cutscenes in total are longer in length than all three Metal Gear Solid games. That is true. But how much longer? So, Metal Gear Solid 1, I think I had about 6 or 7 hours. I think maybe I'm over exaggerating. Maybe it's like 6 hours of cutscenes. Two had like 8. Okay. Three had like 7. Four had 9. 9 hours of cutscenes. That's 4. Is it that much more? And also, are we counting the coded conversation time? Because if we do, then holy crap, Metal Gear Solid 2 has a lot of those moments where you're not playing the game, but you're just watching or listening to the game. So the too many cutscenes thing is a comment that people who don't like Metal Gear as a franchise will make. But if you're a fan of the series, I don't know, like, I don't really see why you would make that complaint if you're a fan of the franchise. You already know this is how it is. You say, if the cutscenes are there, they're meant to be watched, in response to skip them if you don't like them. And I think that's a good response. I agree with that response. If the cutscenes are there, they're meant to be watched. You can criticize the cutscenes because they're there. And I agree. And, you know, when we criticize kind of the things in the game, like, oh, this cutscene was bad, like, I kind of like that discussion that we're having. But when you just, like, generalize, you know, discussions is like, Metal Gear Solid 4 cutscenes are boring, but Metal Gear Solid 2 cutscenes are not boring. Like, that really, I don't know. I don't know what to say to that, because there's really nothing much to say to that. Another point. Everything is fucking nanomachines. So this is kind of one of the major criticisms of Metal Gear Solid 4's kind of plot device. And in a sense, I can agree with the frustration. Somewhat, but I think it's explained mostly. Some parts are like, what? But mostly, okay, the what part is Naomi's cancer. Like, seriously. Nanomachines? Seriously? You know, that, I think, is just, you know, kind of pushed it for me. But for the most part, I think the explanations were pretty amazing. To me, at least. But everything, this everything is fucking nanomachine sentiment, I didn't really feel that with MGS4. And I replayed this game, even watching the cutscenes multiple times. I didn't really feel that with MGS4. I felt this way with Metal Gear Rising. So I mentioned I haven't played this game, but I've watched an entire playthrough of Rising. And the Senator, seriously? Nanomachines, son! Like, that's gotta be a meme, right? Like, what? Like, that was nanomachines too pushing it. But MGS4, I think Daddy did an okay job of explaining things. With the Patriot, there was a lot of retconning, you know? Metal Gear Solid 2 was just like, oh my gosh, Patriots, they've been alive for over 100 years. That was retconned. Ocelot's arm thing, that was kind of explained away. Not retconned, but explained away. That's another one thing that you really didn't like. So JermtheWorm26 just didn't get the sense of this whole Ocelot's arm thing. He said from the 3 games, there was a build-up. In the first game, he got his arm cut off. He's like, that was cool. In the second game, he replaced it with Liquid Snake's arm. And so now Liquid is kind of, he's internally struggling. Liquid's trying to take over his body. He was like, that was cool. And then the third, he's like, but now you're finding out more in MGS3 that Ocelot was the son of the Sorrow. And that's why he has these, like, spiritual powers. And that is cool. And then MGS4 is like, does away with that. And he was very upset because he says that ruins the 3 games kind of build up. First, that was kind of the point. Maybe he didn't like that, but that was kind of the point that Kojima was making there. Also, Metal Gear Solid 2, like, I think a lot of people are like, you know, Metal Gear Solid 4 tries to explain away the supernatural, and that is inconsistent with the franchise. Not necessarily true. If you remember the scene in Metal Gear Solid 2 where Ocelot has that bullet dodging machine thing. I don't know if they ever named that device, but he's just like, there's no such thing as a supernatural, everything is explained by science, which is countered by Fortune using supernatural power to do that, you know. So there is kind of a bit of balance between what is the supernatural actually exists or not. That is that balance there. And Metal Gear Solid 4, I think, you know, says, kind of gives the message that technology is really what there is. Even though there are some crazy, ridiculous things, unexplainable things that happen in MGS4. Much of Raiden, for example, is not explained, or is never explained in that game. But Ocelot's arm thing. I think that was, for me, that was one of the most powerful thing about that game. The explanation of Ocelot's arm. Because that explains the entire saga. You know, why did Big Boss do what he did? Why did Liquid Snake get manipulated by Solid Snake in that manner? It explains everything. Like, it ties the entire saga together. And if you play Peace Walker, like, it ties it even more further together. There is a connection there that didn't exist before MGS4 that now exists. That connection, maybe not such a thing to your liking, but that's what MGS4 accomplished. And Ocelot's arm is an example of that. So I actually really like that. And of course, to JermtheWorm26, a lot of the characters felt like unneeded or totally unnecessary. Like, you know, there's this kind of comment about, why is Eba in this game? You know? So her referring to herself as Big Mama is kind of kind of funny. I remember watching that cutscene for the first time with my friend, and I was like, seriously? Like, what? Big Mama? It was funny. And that was kind of like really corny and cheesy, and probably they should not have done that. But, you know, Eba, I think, to the overall plot, Eba was extremely important as one of the members of the Patriots. And also, as one of the, you know, as she's literally surrogate mother of the three snakes. And so, that's certainly interesting. I just don't like the fact that, you know, she died the way that she did. So that's probably why she feels pointless, because she just comes and she dies the way that she did. Did she have to die knowing? So this is actually a debatable point. Many Metal Gear fans are kind of split on this. Did Big Mama know? Did Eba know of Ocelot's ultimate end goal, or did she not? If she did know, then she died on purpose. If she didn't know, then her death was accidental. You know, I'm more of the opinion that it was not accidental. That it was kind of to push Snake along. To push Snake along is the main theme, is one of the central themes of all four games, right? To kind of get you to think that, oh, you know, you're doing this out of your own free will, but actually, you know, you're being manipulated by forces higher and bigger than you. That's one of the central themes of all Metal Gear games. And if Eba killed herself on purpose, that central theme makes sense. If not, that also makes sense. Kind of. Not really that, you know. What was kind of weird about that is Eba would know that which side of the eye patch Big Boss had on. So Eba must know, right? That's why she kind of died on purpose. Yeah. It seems like every single character from MGS is in here. That's kind of true. This is a very fan service game. You know, this game is really, Metal Gear Solid 4 is really for the fans. I guess some fans were put off by that, and, you know, so whatnot. The fact that, you know, Johnny marries Meryl, that whole sequence is kind of weird, right? And it's very corny and cheesy. But you also have to remember that, you know, a lot of the cutscenes in Metal Gear games are Kojima's homages to movies that he just really liked. And this is true for all Metal Gear games. Seriously, Metal Gear Solid 3 had so many homages to James Bond films and the films of the 60s and the 70s. Metal Gear Solid 2 had homages to Terminator. Like, the intro sequence, did Snake really have to, like, drop down like that? No, he didn't. That was an homage to the Terminator. Just like how, you know, Meryl and John having a shootout like that while proposing to each other is an homage to Mr. and Mrs. Smith. You know, Kojima does these things. He loves movies, he loves filmmaking, and he makes homages. Even though sometimes that just doesn't really make sense. It's not consistent with the overall thing. That's just what Kojima does. In the case of, you know, Metal Gear Solid 4, I thought it was pretty comedic. You know, I thought it was pretty funny. Like, to me, that was interesting. I don't know, to you, maybe it was a boring cutscene. The only cutscene that wasn't boring to JermtheWorm26 was the fight between Raiden and Bamp, the first fight. Although there's also a second fight, but it's hard to watch because you're also playing the game at the same time. MGS4 is one of the most unique games that has done that, the split screen thing, which was interesting. Doesn't mention the microwave cutscene also. That was, like, I guess, not literally gameplay. But also, it makes sense why Old Snake is the Old Snake that he is. I think I resonated with Old Snake because I've grown up with this franchise. Just as Kojima has kind of grown with this franchise, we're at that stage now where we're just like, this is our sixth game in the series. And it's just like, you know, Snake has experienced so much. And to show that, he is old, but also to have us experience it, we're tapping on that triangle button and our fingers are so fucking hurting, just like how Snake is hurting, but all these things are going around. That was like a central message of Metal Gear Solid 4. You know, it's just like, we have come to experience all these things, and now it's finally coming to a close. And it's not only coming to a close because of the story, but freaking A, Snake's body is dying out. It's closing. Even if the world was peaceful all the time, you know, no matter what, Snake is going to die in 6 months because his body is giving out, because of Fox Eye and because of his the way his cloning was designed to be. You know, I think that's a pretty amazing message to have in the game. That's a fourth wall breaking subtle message in the game. And many video games don't even try to do that. And that's how you know this is Kojima's game. And that's what makes Metal Gear Solid 4 probably considered as one of the most hair-raising or debatable masterpieces. You know, is it a masterpiece or not? Did, you know, like, people will argue and fight over it because of things like that. To me, it is, because, like, just because no other game in the medium does things like these, at least not in this manner. I think games are evolving so quickly now that we're starting to see so much of this in many different games, especially indie games now, which is a very exciting time for games. But in 2008, not really. So, still, you know, you just gotta think. Put yourself back in 2008. This is, I think Metal Gear Solid 4 in many ways is a game beyond its time, because of the things that it does that maybe you don't like, that maybe JermtheWorm26 and other people who don't like or don't really understand Metal Gear Solid as much, you know, they don't get it, which is fine. You know, they don't like it, they don't like it. But here's my response to your kind of critiques as a Metal Gear fan. Of course, the last point that he makes is, why does Big Boss come back in the end only to die? He just explains things. So, first time I watched this cutscene, the epilogue cutscene, I too was kind of like, okay, well that was pretty damn amazing because it just answered everything. But then I was like, dang, like, so why does Big Boss die? Like, that was kind of stupid. Like, I want him to live on after he explains all that, you know, but he just... And him coming to die means... Big Boss chose death. Why would Big Boss choose to kill himself this way? You know? It's Solid Snake who should have been able to kill himself, right? Because of the virus. It's kind of a scary thing. There is a biological weapon inside Solid Snake that might mutate to become a weapon anytime. It's just that two different Fox Dyes are competing against each other inside Solid Snake's body. That's making it so that Solid Snake is not a biological terror threat, right? Like, Metal Gear Solid 4 is a pretty complex story. I love it. Maybe he didn't like it. But that's kind of like, so why did Big Boss choose to kill himself in this manner? This bothered me for so long. I have no idea. I thought this was one of the biggest plot holes of Metal Gear Solid 4. Then Peace Walker. Peace Walker explains this. Or starts to explain it. I think Phantom Pain will really explain it. The ending speech that Big Boss makes, or not the ending speech, before that, you know, the final dialogue he has with Kazuhira Miller about the boss. You know, the boss's AI was made into the Peace Walker robot. So now this is Peace Walker spoiler territory. If you haven't played Peace Walker, you probably shouldn't be watching this part. But Peace Walker, the robot, the Metal Gear, goes, pretty much commits suicide for the safety of the world, because if Peace Walker, if the boss's AI did not commit suicide at that point, then there would be a nuclear world war that would happen. And that's what Coldman wanted. I forgot the name. I think it's Coldman. I'm starting to forget the character's names of Peace Walker. But that's what the CIA person wanted, you know, to for that nuclear war to happen. And of course, Snake doesn't want, Big Boss doesn't want that. And so, on the one hand, he's glad the boss, AI, committed that sacrifice. But then he says this, we are weapons. I'm a weapon. You know, weapons should be used. Always. So, he saw this as a fundamental point. This is the fundamental point where he's just like, I'm not like the boss. I have my own will that I will carry out. I'm not going to carry out the boss's will because that is not my will. From now on, call me Big Boss. That's the moment he decides that he's going to accept his codename of surpassing the boss. Before that point, he always thought he was inferior to the boss. That's why he didn't like the codename Big Boss, because Big Boss means he surpassed even the boss. He never felt that way, especially after learning about the truth from Eva. But now, he disagrees with the boss's actions. That's why he's able to call himself Big Boss. So, in Metal Gear Solid 4, when he decides to give up by introducing himself to his clone, Solid Snake, he does exactly what the boss has done. To give up as a weapon. To recognize that the boss was actually right. That's why he gives that salute at the end to the boss. So, Peace Walker explains MGS4 in a way that I didn't think was like, you know. So, Big Boss dying had significance. That is what I want to say. You know, I think if you really analyze things in Metal Gear Solid 4 or any Metal Gear games, things kind of start to make sense. Some parts, like, doesn't make sense as much, but there is a reason, like, there's kind of an explanation for these things here and there that kind of just like, whoa, seriously? That's how it is? But yeah, that's how I understand it. You know, Big Boss came to meet Solid Snake to explain to him, you know, like, this war is the life I have chosen, but now war is the life I give up, and so should you for the next 6 months. And I think he was just kind of waiting there to see if Solid Snake would pull the trigger or not. And Solid Snake is not able to pull the trigger because he's not able to give himself up. And I think that's the spirit he saw, Big Boss saw himself, inside himself. Because I think Big Boss maybe thinks that if he was given the same mission as the boss to sacrifice himself for the good of the nation, Big Boss probably would have refused. And that is exactly what Solid Snake did. He refused to kill himself for the good of the world. He couldn't do it. And so I think there's a kind of a tie that he saw there. It's like, okay. And that's why he's just like, the first thing he says to Solid Snake is, good. You know, that's what you should do. Not give up. Solid Snake is all surprised. And that's the epilogue of the story. And that's how the entire Metal Gear Solid saga ends like that. Now that I understand more of the ending through Peace Walker, of course, Peace Walker comes after MGS4, so this is how Kojima kind of way of explaining things that way. You know, it's after the fact, so maybe it's not as impactful. But, you know, still, like, I'm curious to see how Phantom Pain kind of connects the dots even more. Because each iteration really does connect the dot, whether through retcons or through further plot twist or whatever. I think that's what makes this game series particularly powerful. So that's my critique of Metal Gear Solid 4. My critique of Metal Gear Solid 4. This is my understanding of Metal Gear Solid 4, and that's why I don't find Metal Gear Solid 4 to be boring. I actually find it to be highly interesting, highly thought-provoking, and just very complex and quite amazing way to tie the entire series together. But that's my view. JermtheWorm26 just sees it as a boring, one of the worst Metal Gear games there. So those are our differences of opinions. This was going to be a long video, so it ended up being freaking 44 minutes. Holy crap. But yeah, hope you guys enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching. Cheers.